How does a daughter of the civil rights movement view things today? Peggy Wallace Kennedy, whose father was former Governor George Wallace, has a unique story. She'll share it next on Global Perspectives.
This is Global Perspectives with Pulitzer Prize-winning commentator John Bercia.
Welcome to Global Perspectives. From growing up in the Alabama governor's mansion in the 1960s to endorsing Barack Obama for president, Peggy Wallace Kennedy has witnessed a transformation. Still, she says, the work on behalf of change and reconciliation is never finished.
Welcome to the show, Peggy.
Thank you very much.
Take us back to the 1960s. When you were a young person in Alabama, living in the governor's mansion, what was going through your mind?
Well, I lived in the governor's mansion during my teenage years, during the tumultuous time of the civil rights movement and all the activity that was happening there in Alabama, all the horrible things that were going on, and I really lived a quiet indifference behind the governor's mansion. And it was very hard to see those different things on TV, and Edmund Pettus Bridge, of course, and the 16th Street Baptist Church bombing and all of that. But it was hard, but I was lived behind the governor's mansion gates while all of that was going on.
Did you want to say something, or did you feel it wasn't your place?
Well, in our family business, it was politics. I didn't really, I had an opinion, but we never were really asked what that opinion was. I know the schoolhouse door stand, I did have an opinion. I really thought my father was wrong about that. I did not agree that he should have stood in the schoolhouse door. I really disagreed with him with that. I did not, of course, I did not tell him that. I was 13 years old. But to me, that was an illogical thing for him to do. I was, even at 13, I thought it was illogical. He was a lawyer and a former judge, and I knew he understood Brown versus Board of Education, but he wanted to do that because he had said that that's what he would do, was stand in the schoolhouse door. But I disagreed with that action that he took.
He also had, at the time, many progressive ideas in other aspects of politics. But in this particular area, do you think he was pressured by other people to maintain that position? Because later in life, he eventually did change his views and stated so publicly.
I think that the stand in the schoolhouse door was something that he wanted to do because he had said that's what he was going to do. Later on in life, when he changed, I think his injuries that he sustained in 1972, he began to look at his politics and from the past, and he saw where he needed to change, and through his suffering, and that he had made others suffer, and that's when he began to change.
You made the trip back to the schoolhouse doorstep many, many years later. What was that experience? Was that the first time you had been there?
That was last year, mm-hmm. and that was a wonderful experience for me. I was there with John Lewis. I was there with Sharon Malone, Vivian Malone's sister. It was just a wonderful experience to stand and speak and just sort of it was closure for me, I think, more than anything. But it was a wonderful, wonderful time for me.
When did you begin to feel that you did have an opinion that should be shared as you were growing and maturing? Was it in your teenage years or was it later?
Well, it was much, much later. Of course, I had been living under the shadow of the schoolhouse door for most of my life. And when I endorsed President Obama in 2008, he just inspired me so much. He gave me so much courage. And he talked about change in America and change in yourself. And he really gave me the courage to change myself. And so I said, you know, I need to leave a legacy to my children that's not going to be anything close to the schoolhouse door. So I knew that I had to step away from the schoolhouse door and start a legacy for my boys of my own. And so that's what I have done.
So you always had very good communication with them on this particular issue, even though you didn't have good communication with your father
right.
on this issue. And that's something that you said you just dealt with because you yes. needed to, but you weren't happy about it because it left
right.
unresolved a major aspect of your experience.
Right. And it just was something there was never any time to talk about things. I never had an explanation or had a conversation with him about it, but of other things. But I didn't want that to happen with my boys. We talked about it before I told them I was going to come out and talk about a legacy that I wanted to leave to them and that I wanted to step away from the shadow of the schoolhouse door, and they were in agreement. They wanted me to do that. I said, because I want this legacy to be yours. I don't want anything negative to be in your legacy.
Now, did you go through the same experience that your father went through? Because when he was for segregation, there were some people who supported him and others who criticized him. And then later in life, when he changed his position, many of the people who had supported him disliked the new stance. And many of the people who had criticized him actually came to support him, both personally and in other ways. Did something like that happen to you? Did you feel that you were all of a sudden criticized because you were being very vocal about your feelings and the fact that you didn't like what was going on during the period of segregation?
No, not really. I just never really talked to anybody about it. I mean, I just really kept my opinion to myself.
But later when your opinions were being stated, were people critical of you?
No, they were not.
Even in Alabama?
Even in Alabama. Mm-hmm. I mean, I've had some criticism, but not much. I think people realize now that I'm a grown adult, and I can, you know, say and do what I want to. But they also saw my daddy change mm-hmm. in the end too, and they know that at his last governor's race, had it not been for the African American vote, he would not have been. Had been elected.
Now, you have been an educator. What do you feel is good about the public school system today as far as sharing the message of what happened during the Civil Rights Movement, and what is lacking?
Well, I do think that it should be taught in the schools about civil rights. the movement and what's happened, because we've come 50 years. It's 50 years later. We have a long way to go, but there's some things happening in this country, and it's almost like we're slipping back a little bit. We don't want to do that. And so we need to teach our children tolerance, because that's what they need to live. They need to live tolerance. So we need to teach them that.
What do you feel is the biggest success story of the civil rights movement as you look back over the past 50 years? What is the one aspect of it that you find very, very satisfying?
I guess Vivian Malone and James Hood, I guess. My daddy may have stood in that schoolhouse door, but Vivian and James walked through that schoolhouse door and changed America.
Mm-hmm.
That was, to me, one of the greatest things that ever happened.
And then you decided to endorse Barack Obama.
Yes.
How did you come to that decision?
He just inspired me. And he just gave me courage and truth. And our son was overseas. And we endorsed Obama because we were so hoping that he would become our son's commander-in-chief. And we were very happy about that. And I just believed that he was the man that this country needed at that time, and he was.
So that was another success.
Yes.
If you will. What about the things that haven't happened? What is it about the lack of progress in certain areas in terms of civil rights that bothers you? What would you change if you could change something today?
Well, I think we certainly don't have health care. So many families do not have access to good health care, or their children don't have access to good education. Those are the two most important things to me, I think.
How do we fix the education problem? Because the whole point of the Brown versus Board of Education case was to say that separate wasn't equal, but there are still so many schools that are separate in many ways and not equal because of a variety of things, from the way taxes are collected to the way people live in communities. So how do you fix that? Is there a different formula that we should use for determining how schools are funded?
You know, I just think that You just have to get all the people that are really, really educated in that way together, and educators, and try to fix it. I don't know how you go about fixing it. I really don't, because it's in a really bad shape.
After your father's accident, of the attack on him, and he was in a wheelchair, did he talk any more about his beliefs regarding civil rights, or was he still keeping a lot of that to himself?
He talked some about it. He talked about the pain and suffering that he had expressed, that he had suffered. He realized that he had made the African Americans suffer. He was upset about that, and he did a lot of things. When he was after 1972, before he died, he did a lot of a lot of good. Alabama will remember him for a lot of things that he did for people. The war will remember him for the asterisk by his name for the man that stood in the schoolhouse door. Mm-hmm. You know, that's what I say a lot because that's what it'll be. But Alabama knows that after 72, he did a lot for Alabamians, African-Americans and whites.
And what about you? You've been speaking out more and more in recent years. What do you think your legacy is going to be, or what would you want it to be?
I would hope that my legacy would be that I found my voice with the help of President Obama, who gave me the courage and inspired me to do so, that I could speak up and speak out, and that I would leave a legacy to my two boys, that their mother did speak up and speak out, and that she had her own voice, and that my mother was governor for only 15 months. And within that 15 months, if you could have seen her, she found her voice, and then she passed away. And so there are a lot of times that I speak that I really feel like I'm carrying on for her and carrying her voice on, because she had really just come into her own. So, but I'd like for my boys to remember that their mother found their own voice. And when you can help another person find their voice and help them love themselves and know that they can love themselves when they find that voice, you've done a good thing.
How do your children perceive the whole civil rights issue? Is it something that they think about and talk about on a regular basis?
No.
Do you ever talk to them and
no.
seek their opinions?
No. Mm-mm. I think we've talked about it since I've, you know, traveled and but not, you know, long conversations or anything like that. Both of my sons have marched in Selma. They will again this next March. They're involved, but they accept what I do. And so I'm very proud of them for being proud of me.
Now, you go out and speak to audiences all over the country.
Mm-hmm.
And generally, are people accepting and supportive of what you say, or do you still encounter critics from time to time?
No, people generally are very supportive of what I say.
Did you ever keep a diary during all those years?
No,
growing up? Because I'm thinking that would have been such
a
rich
great.
Source of information
yes.
And,
yes.
And insights into your thought process at the time. Did you ever take up diary writing later in life, or you just never did that?
I just never did that. All my girlfriends had a diary, but it was about boys, I think.
Well, that's understandable. Much more interesting than politics. So what is it you hope to do over the next 5 years in terms of your legacy, in terms of civil rights? Do you feel that we're moving? You said that you were fearful that we were moving in the wrong direction in some respects. Why is that? And what can you do to help it?
Well, I'm just hoping that each time I go out and speak, that is another personal journey for me, and that it's another stone I'm laying on my foundation for my boys. Mm-hmm. And that's another way of speaking up and speaking out, and for racial equality and for discrimination, you know, economic discrimination, job discrimination, education discrimination, just, I was a daughter of the movement, and I, like I said, I saw all of that tumultuous rage behind the doors of the governor's mansion, behind the gates of the governor's mansion. And I wish now that I had kept a diary, of course, but now I'm going back and trying to connect myself with each incident that happened, you know, and reading up on it and that kind of thing. And just when I go out, I just try to teach people that they can speak up and speak out and find, and when they do find their voice, that they've done a great thing for themselves when they can find their own voice inside.
Mm-hmm. You talk a lot about reconciliation. How important is reconciliation in this process?
Well, you know, John Lewis, who I love very much, he's the one that says that healing and reconciliation can heal the human heart, that love and reconciliation can heal the human heart. And he's right.
But to overcome the fear and the distrust and all of the other issues that divide people who have had different and often combative experiences, how do you begin to ease the fear and build the trust? Is it communication? Is it empathy? Do you have to show as well as talk about what you'd like to do?
Yeah.
And how do you go about that? I mean, if you're sitting down with someone for the first time who maybe knows the history of civil rights movement in the context of your father, but nothing about what you have done and contributed, how do you begin to persuade that person that you're talking about a solution that is similar to theirs?
Well, I would just tell them what I have been doing, and I probably would ask them for suggestions. Do you have any suggestions than what I've been doing? And hopefully they could help me. And then I could engage them into my conversation, and that I could make them feel at ease that they were sitting there talking to me. I would want that. I would want them to make them feel at ease talking to me.
What is your biggest hope personally? What do you think could happen in 5 years or 10 years if we stay on the right path? Do you see an improvement in the civil rights environment? Because, you know, we've been going one step forward, two steps back on occasion,
yeah.
But we have to, you've said before, we have to stay on that course, as you have stayed on that course.
We just have to stay on the course, and hopefully we can do that, and just keep moving forward like we have been, and hopefully we won't be one step forward and two steps back. Maybe we'll just keep on moving forward. We have to. We can't go back.
Great. Well, thank you, Peggy Wallace Kennedy, for joining us today.
Thank you.
And thank you. For Global Perspectives, I'm John Bercia, and we'll see you next time.